Okay.
So
we still have a couple of callers that haven't identified themselves.
Right, we'll get to them. So I'm just writing to I don't know why. Let me send that to Len.
By the way, Rick, I think they updated the software when I logged on, and it seems to be working fine right now.
Oh, good. Okay.
So, I think they updated me automatically.
Okay.
Somebody's crackling a whole bunch.
Yeah, I don't know who will find it.
Frank, speak up again one time, would
number
you please?
Number 9 for Frank.
Okay.
Yeah, I thought I identified him already. Then I identified somebody incorrectly.
Okay.
The shadow.
The shadow.
The shadow.
The shadow. Okay. And I see that Steve Bornstein's on. We're coming on. Quarter 12 has arrived.
Oh, Frank must have dropped off at one point because I had him named and then he...
Yeah, well, I'm still here.
Keep us confused, Frank. That's way to go, Frank. Keep us confused.
Well, I'm always confused. That's just standard procedure.
Well, now you're confusing us.
All right. So let me make a note of who I've got, and then I will call everybody's name, and then we'll get started. We're giving Jim Harrington the 2-minute warning. Jay Curran, Bornstein. Frank Kelly, Cameron. We haven't had any weather reports from around the country today. Anybody want to volunteer a weather report whilst I'm writing all these names down?
Our snow is all gone.
It was another beautiful day in San Diego.
Okay. Beautiful day in San Diego. No snow in Idaho. What's going on in the East Coast?
Spring has finally arrived in New York. Finally.
Okay.
It was 85 and sunny down in Venice, Florida today.
Okay.
81 in Tucson.
Well, that sounds good.
Sunny in 65 in Maryland. Not too bad.
I think it was in the 70s here. All I know is I rode in a tank top, so that my weather, I define my weather by what I have to wear when I go row. I'm still riding Steve Korn, Sylvester Mann.
Windy in San Francisco and hardly a cloud in the sky.
Oh, well, there
I already have a Coke.
There you go.
I have 2, actually. Thank you.
Okay. All right. So I am going to tell you who I know is on the call, and then you'll tell me if I've missed anybody. So Jake, Jim Harrington, Dennis Correa, Jay Curran, Steve Bornstein, Frank Kelly, Larry Fish, Len Sierra, Peter Kafka, Steve, I've got Steve Korn twice. No, Steve Korn, Sylvester Mann. Who have I missed?
Mike Tamales.
Mike Tamales. Okay. Hello. I bet you got nice weather in Maui, don't you?
Yeah, I just didn't want to, like, rub it in.
Okay. We got people in San Diego who are enjoying the weather and people in San Francisco. And so, anyone else?
Yeah, Paul Frieda just connected.
Paul Frieda. Okay.
Thank you. Ivo Lincecum.
Sorry, who was that last one?
Jim Cameron in Venice.
I got you, Jim. Did I not?
Oh, okay.
I didn't call your name.
Ivo.
Tebow, welcome.
Hi.
Haven't heard your voice for too long. Great to hear you. Tebow Lincecum. Okay, let me run down again and then see if there's anyone now. So Jake, Jim Harrington, Dennis Correa, Jay Curran, Steve Bornstein, Frank Kelly, Larry Fish, Len Sierra, Peter Kafka, Steve Korn, Sylvester Mann, Mike Tamales, Paul Frieda, Jim Cameron, Tebow Lincecum. Anyone else?
Skip.
Oh, Skip. That's right. Sorry. I do.
Oh, that's okay.
Okay. Skip Maniscalco. Any more?
Jay Kern, but maybe I just didn't catch it.
No, I called you. We got a couple of people that haven't identified. If you would like to, you're more than welcome. If not, that's no problem either.
If Tebow could speak up one more time, so I can identify
him.
I think he's on the phone.
Yeah, I'm on the phone.
13.
Okay.
13.
Thank you.
Okay. All right. Well, look, welcome, everybody. The good news, I don't know if it's good news, but we don't have anybody who hasn't been on the call before, I don't think. Which is great because we have plenty of time to speak with Jim Harrington. Jim has very kindly offered to tell us a little bit about the trial that he's participating in, which is this Advaxis Keytruda trial. We'll tell you a lot more about it, but essentially it uses the listeria virus to reach prostate cancer cells and essentially make these cells more alert to Keytruda, which is the follow-up drug. And I know that Jim's been talking about participating in this trial for 2 or 3 years now with his oncologist, and has finally taken the leap. He's done 2 sessions. Jim, you might want to let people know what you've done before, because some people aren't quite as familiar, and I'll hand the floor over to you.
Thanks, Rick. Sure. My name is Jim Harrington. I'm in New Jersey. And my treatment and my trial take place at the Cancer Institute of New Jersey, which is in New Brunswick, New Jersey. And my doctor is Dr. Stein, so he's my med-onc. I'll tell you about this trial. It hasn't gone back quite that far, Rick, but it's been underway and under planning for a long time. And what this trial is for those who are metastatic castrate-resistant. And in my own case, I have failed both drugs, Zytiga and Xtandi. So I didn't get very far with either one of them, and I've had no chemo, but I have bone mets all up and down my spine and so forth, but I have no pain. And another thing I might add is that my PSA, it's going to sound kind of low to many of you, and probably, as my doctor says, because I don't make a lot of PSA. Good or bad or indifferent, that's just a fact at the moment, so we'll leave it at that. But this trial that I start on is might interest some of you. It's an interesting trial, and it involves an immunotherapy drug, pembrolizumab, otherwise known as Keytruda. And Keytruda is made by Merck, and I suspect, like I have, some of you seen their ads on TV, that is the Keytruda ads. It's been approved for 2 cancers, skin cancer, melanoma, and also for a non-small cell lung cancer. It's been given to about 50,000 people, that is pembrolizumab. It's an immunotherapy drug. And so they're trying it with prostate cancer, but it has not been tried, okay? Be sure to understand that. And so this study is a study which involves this immunotherapy drug, pembrolizumab, or Keytruda, and if you watch the ads of Merck, you'll see that they start off by telling you, well, this is going to be a lot better than chemotherapy and put your cancer in durable remission and blah, 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 blah. Well, yeah, let's hope that happens. Mm-hmm. So the way this study is it's a combination of the pembrolizumab, the immunotherapy drug, and listeria. Now, if listeria conjures up all kinds of bad things in your mind, people of food poisoning and people dying, yeah, that's true. Listeria is it's a bacteria, and what this is, listeria is modified listeria, so nobody dies. It's by a company, as Rick said, Advaxis. And Advaxis is the one that actually sponsors this study. I think a little bit of help from Merck, but anyway, the way it works is you're giving infusions of these two drugs on a cycle of 1 week, 4 weeks, 7 weeks, and 10 weeks. And so it's sort of like chemo, I guess, but it is not chemo. And I don't lose my hair, nothing like that. What the purpose is, what Rick wanted me to mention that, what's the purpose of giving the listeria? Normally, with the pembrolizumab, you don't give any other thing. But the purpose of the listeria is to, as they say, to enhance the body's ability to attach to more tumor cells. So it's more or less to kind of amp up your immune system so that the pembrolizumab will be even more active. And so that's the idea of the listeria. Now, all I can tell you is I've been on the trial. I've had my second infusion. And my doctor said, I said, how am I going to feel? What's going to happen to me? And he said, you're going to feel a little crappy for a day. Yeah. Well, I'll tell you, there's a little bit of getting used to this. It's not quite as simple as all that. There are side effects. So what happens is you go into the cancer clinic. You have the pembrolizumab first. And by the way, just you might be interested in these immunotherapy drugs are expensive. This one infusion of pembrolizumab is about $20,000. That's what I'm told. But remember, in this trial, I pay for nothing. All of this is paid by Advaxis. And so that's how it works. And then you're given some anti-nausea drugs and some other drugs. And then you wait an hour. Then you have the infusion of the listeria. And the only thing I can tell you is that all men here in New Jersey that are doing this have had chills and the shakes. And all of a sudden, it comes on, like boom. And you're chills, and you're shaking, and you're in your bed, and they call it code yellow, which means about six people rush in the room and look at me, shaking sort of, not violently, but and they give me Demerol, and they said, this is going to calm you down, and boy, is that true. Within a minute, you have no chills. Anyway, that's just a little bit of a side information for you. This trial has this cycle of 1, 4, 7, and 10 weeks. And you're given for week 1, 4, and 7, you're given the listeria. The 10th week, you don't get the listeria. You just get pembrolizumab. It's a fairly long day. It's about 12 hours because they will make you wait 4 hours after it's all over so that you don't go flop, boom, right on your face because your blood pressure can go up, your blood pressure can go down. Anyway, all I know is it's annoying because I got to sit there for 4 hours, but the trials are very structured. You can't miss them. You can't miss the dates and so forth. The only side effect I've had is, it's partly pembrolizumab, is that a loss of appetite. And I found that you've got to eat. You know, like many of you on the calls have said, you've got to force yourself sometimes to eat. But other than that, and some fatigue, but it's not bad. And I'm learning to adjust to this, and particularly taking these opioids when they give you these injections of opioids, and you can get constipation. So we're putting that aside. That's the trial. Now, the side effects, you can get flu-like symptoms. I don't. Fever, chills, but I don't. This cycle of 1, 4, 7, and 10 weeks goes on for 2 years. 2 years. After the 2 years of these cycles, you have 3 years of observation. It turns out that you got to kill listeria. So After the infusion, 72 hours later, you must take an antibiotic. So I take ampicillin, or you can take a sulfa drug, not me because I'm allergic to them. But you take this starting 72 hours later to kill the listeria they just put in your body through all these marvelous things. Now, listeria can hang around. It can have a late dormancy and so forth. That's why After this two-year cycle, they monitor you for 3 years. Anyway, of course, they can cancel these trials anytime. This is a phase one trial. I did try to get some information on where it's being done. For those of you interested in this, you can go to clinicaltrials.gov. I know you recommend this, Rick. There's a number. I can give you the number if you want, but or you can just put it at Advaxis in or something. You can see about this trial. I see San Francisco, Colorado, Maryland, Pennsylvania, and Rhode Island. I'm sorry, I don't know the hospitals. I don't know where they are, but that's really my story. I want to conclude with one thing. I want to tell you my first result. My week one, my PSA was 2.4. On the fourth, 3 weeks later, just 3 weeks later, it dropped to 1.49. Well, my medonc was beside himself with joy. I thought that was great news. I mean, that's only 3 weeks. Now, who knows what's going to happen? This thing bounces up and down. But it certainly was good news, and I'm hoping for the best because I've not had chemo. You can have had chemo and enter this trial. They are recruiting. They are recruiting, and you can't have chemo. You can't have Xtandi or Zytiga, I don't think, during the trial. The only thing you can have is Lupron. You can keep taking Lupron forever. So that's really the story, Rick. Happy to tell any more men about it. It's a special trial. Let me point out, it's a risk. There's no proof, no indication that this combination is going to work for prostate cancer. I figure that, like all these things, they're tested on animals. So somewhere there's a nice mouse running around. It's happy. But I don't know. In 2 years of this, you know, my gosh, I hope I make it through this and this thing really works. There's no question that pembrolizumab does work. In fact, even in the Cancer Institute, they use it on other patients, and it really does work, apparently. I mean, giving it to 50,000 people, a lot of them are on research studies. So I'm Jim Harrington. I'm happy to help anybody. Rick knows how to contact me through email if I can be of any help to you. You would have to be near a center to really participate in this, but they are recruiting people, and in our case, it would be 15 men at the Cancer Institute who will ultimately participate in it.
So I have...
That's all I have, Rick.
No, that's great. Thank you very much for...
Oh, you're most welcome. Happy to help all the guys.
I have a couple of questions just first, and then...
Sure.
I'll move along. And by the way, I have shared my screen, and I've put the trial up. I don't know. I'm not sure if you're seeing it, because I have two screens here. Can you see?
Is that the 0232-5557? That's the NCT or National Cancer Trials. Anyway, you can find it. It's
That's the trial that I've put up. Can other people see
okay.
my screen?
Just see the Mount Tam, your screensaver.
Okay, so hold
no.
on. Now you can see it then. I wasn't sure which screen you were on. Okay. So there you go.
Not yet.
We're still just seeing the sunset over Mount Tam.
Oh, okay.
What's the name of the trial?
The trial is called, what's the name of the trial? It's protocol ADXS142-03. It's just by Advaxis is the company. It's just called trying the combination of pembrolizumab and in patients treated with metastatic castrate-resistant prostate cancer in combination with the listeria.
Hold on, Jim. If you got my notice, if you saw my notice, there's a link to it in my notice. So just go back to the call notice from this week, and the trial is linked in there.
Thanks, Rick.
And the trial number, for those of you who are on the computer online, you can see the trial in the window there. As I'll say the number slowly for those of you who aren't on the trial, it's N as in Nelson, C as in Charlie, T as in Thomas, 023-255-57.
That's right.
And can you repeat that one time?
Yeah. It's NCT 023-255-57. But it's linked linked, Frank, so it'll be in the call notice. Lisa has the link in the last email that I sent out. So she can just click on the link in the letter and she'll get to it. Let me just clarify a couple of things. You say that there's 1, 4, 7, and 10 weeks are the times when you get the pembrolizumab.
That's true. That's right.
Now, and you say the trial lasts for 2 years.
2 years. Now, 2 years. That the cycle 1, 4, 7, 10 repeats.
Okay.
And for 2 years.
So that was my question. So that 1, 4, 7, 10 repeats, but you only get the listeria during the first 3 sessions and not on the.
That's exactly right. The last one they just give you pembrolizumab. Then you go through the test. You get the CT, you get your bone scan, and start all over again.
Okay. So, all right. Why don't I throw it open and. What if you have questions for Jim or for any of us, throw them out. We'll see the best we can do to answer them. I wanted to say one little thing. I'm not sure where I got this from. I've got to try and figure it out. But my understanding is that this particular trial of Keytruda and Advaxis, which is clearly oriented towards prostate cancer.
That's right.
There is some aspect of the listeria Advaxis drug that doesn't just wake up the immune system in general, but it is targeted toward. It's a drug that's targeted towards prostate cancer cells. I think it identifies.
That's exactly right.
PSA.
Yeah, I think they bioengineer, what they do with the listeria is they bioengineer
an
antigen specific for its prostate acid phosphatase, PAP, I believe. So that's why it's unique to prostate cancer.
That's right. Steve, you're right. That's exactly right. It's targeted specifically to the prostate specific antigen, PSA, and that's right. And this combination's never been given from what I read and what they tell us. So it's something new.
So who'd like to step up first?
I have a question, or maybe a couple, Rick and Jim.
Go ahead.
Thanks for telling us about this trial. Very interesting.
Oh, you're most welcome. And I'm sorry I can't be more specific to the sites. What they say is there are going to be 8 sites opening up, but they are certainly recruiting people to it. I just can't tell you exactly where those sites are.
Do you happen to know if each successive cycle they are increasing the dose? Because oftentimes in a phase 1 trial, they'll escalate the dose until they reach a maximum tolerated dose, so they know how to go forward in phase 2 and beyond.
Yes, I said it. What they did is what I didn't tell you was it's a phase 1, but there's a phase 1 part A to part B. I'm in the part B, and they've established those levels of the strength of both the pembrolizumab and the listeria. So I don't, to my knowledge, they won't be changing the strength of these things. I mean, I know what it is, but are they going to leave them as they've already established this? And I just started the trial in part B, which means I get both of them. There's no blind study here. You're just everybody's getting the same thing.
Right. And I was wondering also if they have to call a code yellow after you have your severe chills.
Yeah, right.
Like, why don't they just give you Demerol up front?
Yeah, no, it's a very, very good question. Very good. They did do that. And actually, they warned me about the code yellow. And they said, 6 people are going to rush in here. Don't be alarmed. And they just stare at you, sort of pharmacists, doctors, nurses. They did do that. They gave me the Demerol shot 12 and a half milliliters first, thinking, well, this won't happen. But it did happen. The infusion of the listeria is 2 hours. It can vary an hour, 2 hours. But it was 2 hours of doing slower, so this won't happen. About half an hour toward the end, it happened. And they rushed in, and they gave me another 12 and a half milliliters or whatever it was, and that did it. But that was the thinking. Let's just give him a shot of this Demerol first, and then he won't get the chills. Well, didn't quite happen that way. They're free to change that, but anyway, it's not horrible. Initially, I tried not to shake too much, but they know you're shaking. They put their hand on you, you know, and I was amazed how fast the Demerol works. Wow, boom. They said, this is going to calm you down, Jim. You're just going to stop shaking. You're going to stop having chills within a minute.
The other question I have is, and maybe, Jim, if you don't know the answer, maybe I wonder if Steve does. Since they're giving you an antibiotic, it sounds almost as like this might be a live, attenuated listeria.
Oh, it is. It is live. This is a live strain of listeria monocytogenes.
Monocytogenes.
They make it up, and they and same with the pembrolizumab. But it's mixed somewhere in the Cancer Institute, I guess. But no, it's live.
It's attenuated though, like most vaccines. But I think there isn't enough experience to know what the long term effects might be of the.
That's exactly right, Steve. That's right. In fact, that's why they monitor for 3 years, because it can stay hidden. And I said, well, why do I have to take this ampicillin? I said, well, you've got to. Because you're going to get, you could get an infection.
Yeah, listeria infection is certainly possible, even if it's attenuated. So I assume that's why. Fortunately, it's a bacteria, not a virus, so you can take an antibiotic and it works.
Yeah, right. I don't need it. By the way, Steve, I don't notice any difference on the 72nd hour. I start taking the ampicillin, and I don't do nothing much different. I actually don't feel all that bad. Because I'm a full employee, I'm a professor at Rutgers, and I got to go teach. I've got students that depend on me and so forth. So I just say, look, Jim, get up, get out of bed, get going. I mean, it's not like chemotherapy and some of the stories you guys have told me. But you got to kind of force yourself. It's funny stuff. And I'm hoping that this early drop in the PSA is meaningful. I don't know.
So your PSA has gone down in after the first session or two sessions?
Yeah, after the first session. The first, it was 2.4 at the start of the first cycle, the first treatment. And the second treatment, which was 3 weeks later, dropped to 1.49. I mean, it's not insignificant. So I was pleased. My doc, I guess he was jumping out of his skin. I don't see that because there's a whole team of clinical nurses. All these trials have clinical nurses, and they really are very attentive. And as I say, I don't pay for anything.
So
they're all covered by it.
Hold on a second, Jim. So you started at the beginning of February, right? Is when you had your first session?
My first was in March. No, it was I missed the very first one because I didn't have enough white blood cells or something. I forgot which one it was, but then I made it okay. And because I had, but I think I started on March 10th, something like that. And then I had another one in March, and every 3 weeks.
So hold on a second. You say every 3 weeks, but I thought it was.
Yeah, every 3 weeks.
1 week, 4 weeks. Oh, I see. 1 week, 4 weeks, 7 weeks.
Yeah. I know what you're saying, Rick. It seems so. No, it's just add three to it.
No, I got it. So, and then the second one, you came in at 1.49.
Well, yes, that's right. I mean, 3 weeks later, yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, what I would say to a lot of you guys on the call, of course, it's too early to know whether it's attributable, but a drop for Jim from 2.4 to 1.49 is. A very significant drop for somebody who
never had so
much PSA. I mean, Jim,
that's right.
What's your highest PSA ever been?
8.4.
Yeah. So,
So it's never, no, and in fact, it's, and I'm, of course, I'm only on Lupron when obviously I'm castrate resistant, so that doesn't do it. Right. So there's no reason that it should be held down.
Right.
Because there's no chemo here, there's no Xtandi, there's no Zytiga, there's nothing. And it's all stopped. You can't actually, you can't take Sofigo, you can't take chemo on this trial. And there's one thing you can't do. You cannot take Tylenol. Damnedest thing. And they told me why, but please don't ask me why. But you can take any kind of ibuprofen. Anyway, it's a small factor. But, yeah, I think so, Rick. I'm very pleased.
Who else would like to ask a question?
Jim, this is,
yes,
Skip. I'm wondering, Keytruda, I know there's an association between the effectiveness of Keytruda and the presence of the PD-L1 blocker. And, I'm wondering,
yeah, if that's right,
any tests done for you in that regard.
No, I did not have that tested. Rick had suggested that, and emphatically, I might add, Rick, but... and I did not. I did not have any genetic testing. I did not. I do not know whether this is going to be effective or not. It just, boom, started in. And it is true, the PD-L1, that is required for non-small cell lung cancer and for maybe the dermatology stuff. But no, I don't know.
Well, I think that's probably because of the cost of it commercially. The PD-1, the CTLA genes are required for both melanoma and non-small cell lung cancer.
Yeah.
But since this is a trial, you know, it's being paid for, and so
that's right.
I'm worried about it.
That's right. I think you're right. I think that's what they just, you know, they enrolled me right away. There were six people ahead of me, and they jumped me to the top of the queue. I think, I don't know what happened to the other people, and I said, okay, let's do it.
I mean, the only reason I question that is that if the drug fails, if you don't get a response, I would have thought that they would want to be able to attribute that to,
I see,
to your genes, and this way they don't know whether it was you, whether it was, you know, whether you were a non-starter or not. I just find it strange that they're not testing you up front, but...
I wouldn't argue with you, Rick. I think you make a good point. Maybe Steve says, you know, that there's no charge for this thing, and you just jump into it. But I think what I've been told by my doctor is that some men, PSA goes up somewhat. Sometimes it doesn't change at all. In my case, it went down. So, yeah, I know you make a point.
Steve, go ahead.
Jim, one of the... side effects they talk about with the checkpoint inhibitors, Keytruda and Opdivo, mm-hmm, and the others, is autoimmune disorders that manifest themselves as either hepatitis or joint disease or rash, mm-hmm, et cetera, et cetera.
Oh, yeah.
That stuff yet, huh?
No, I mean, of course, I got the trial in front of me, and I look, they give you a gazillion side effects. And for the pembrolizumab, which is what you're talking about, tired, itchy skin, and there's a little bit itchy in my scalp, not hungry. As far as joint pain, you know, I think some of that comes actually from Lupron. So I don't see any increase. No, I've been, there's a ton of, of different possible side effects from pembrolizumab. And, but no, it doesn't seem to be a problem. I don't see any worse in terms of joint pain, stomach pain, fever. No, it really hasn't done anything. And that's just the pembrolizumab. Say nothing about the side effects of the listeria. Most of that, by the way, is chills. And yeah, I get a little chills now and then. Low hemoglobin. I do have a little bit of, this is for the listeria. I guess my hemoglobin count was a little bit low. They were talking about in transfusion, but I don't know if they're going to do that. But otherwise, I don't have any, back pain, all kinds of things can happen to you with these things. You know, you read all these things. Yeah.
So let me just jump in a moment here. For those of you who are on the computer, you can see the sites where they're currently recruiting.
You can. Oh, okay. Thanks, Rick.
For those of you who are not on the computer, You'll need to pull the trial up, but I will do a couple of things. First of all, I'm going to give you, if you're interested in this trial, I'm going to give you the Advaxis hotline, which is in the trial.
Oh.
It's included in the trial, and their telephone number is 844-783-1529. 844-783-1529. In a minute, I'll put it in the chat window too, so that it'll be there even after I take the Advaxis trial, after I take the trial down. The other thing I'm going to do is just let you know where they're identifying sites right now. California, they just say San Francisco for California. Colorado, University of Colorado Health Sciences Center in Aurora. In Maryland, they just say Rockville. And also in Towson. In New Jersey, it just says New Brunswick. In Pennsylvania, it says Philadelphia. It says Philadelphia, recruiting in Philadelphia, site in Philadelphia. I don't know why. It just identifies Philadelphia, but it identifies it twice. Maybe there's two locations. And in Providence, Rhode Island. Yeah, so that's where they're indicating right now. So how many is that? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So yeah, that's the 8 that Jim Harrington referred to earlier on. So you can track this down. You can Advaxis is spelled ADVAXIX. Again, it's in the email that I send out announcing this call. So you'll find it in there. There's a lot of information about Advaxis on the web. There's a Wikipedia page. A lot of good information. We're going to spend just another 5 or so minutes talking about this. So if anybody else has questions, please speak up now.
Jim, this is Jay Kern.
Go ahead, Jay.
Jim, how long were you on Lupron? And then do they think that... you will have to, or that side effects will stay the same throughout the trial?
Yeah, I've been on Lupron. I'm a Lupron lifer, about 3 years, and they just keep giving it to me every 3 months, sometimes with Xgeva. But no, I don't think there's any, I can't see any connection with the Lupron and any side effects of Lupron and this trial. It doesn't seem to make any difference to me. Lupron doesn't work. Anyway, I mean, I don't know if it works or not, but it doesn't work like it used to. So, no, I don't see any differences with the Lupron.
Hey, Jim, I see that you had Provenge about a year ago.
That's right. That's right.
Chills and fever, kind of common reactions to that. How did your current drug chills compare to Provenge?
Well, that's a very good question. When I'm actually having the infusion of listeria and I actually get the chills and the shakes, no, that's much more intense. But after that, probably a little bit more of the chills in this particular trial. But it's very little. I just make sure I'm always warm and I have a nice sweatshirt on or something like that, or coat and tie. And no, it isn't. It is very small. I don't get these flu-like symptoms, really. It isn't bad at all. So I would say about the same as the Provenge, maybe just a little bit worse.
Okay, thanks.
Anyone else?
Just a little medical tidbit of interest, maybe not, but the Listeria monocytogenes is a bacteria it's the only bacteria known to man that actually induces spontaneous abortions in women, and is found... Mm-hmm. Primarily in, you know, raw cheeses like queso fresca that a lot of Hispanic women eat. So in my experience as an obstetrician, we used to be very wary of it because, you know, having that infection, you hardly know you have the infection, but it induced the first and second trimester miscarriages. So just that's not a problem for prostate cancer, obviously.
Yeah, right, right. That's interesting. No, I didn't know that. But it's certainly been around a long time, and usually conjures up a kind of a bad image if it's if it's not been modified like this.
Yeah, exactly.
And I just learned that it's a bacteria, not a virus. So forgive my.
It's right. That's right. You can kill it
correctly originally. So
yeah. Anyway, I thank all of you for listening to me, and thanks, Rick, for giving me this time. And again, Rick knows how to find me. I'm in New Jersey, and I've already had one person write me looking at Johns Hopkins, but I don't know if, I'm not sure Johns Hopkins participates or not. It's in Maryland, but I'm always happy to help anybody with respect to this, and I'm hoping it works, and I'm hoping that, anyway,
thank
that's all I
thank you very much.
You're most welcome. I'm always happy to help you guys.
I hope it works for you, Jim.
Thank you, Jim.
Yeah, the person who wrote you was actually offered the trial by Antoniakis at Johns Hopkins. So
yes, that's right. Okay.
I don't know whether they're not identified, and I don't think they're in they're not in Rockville. They're in Baltimore, aren't
they? No. That's right. Yeah, I don't. I wrote them. She was very, very happy with my response, and they were gonna. I don't know. Yeah, I don't. I mean, they'd have to go to Rockville.
I don't think that Ron's gonna be eligible because there's an exclusion if you've done more than two different types of chemotherapy. You'll see.
Oh, I see. Okay.
If you do that, and I told them that they should discuss it. There's a lot of exclusion criteria, as you can. See, I've just put it up on the screen, so there's seven different things that they can exclude you for. So anyway,
like a trial.
So you know, it is a trial. All right. Well, thanks a million, and let me. What we're going to do now?
You're welcome.
I'm just going to run through my list again, make sure that no one new has joined us, and. If they have, they'll identify themselves, and we'll find out who needs some time today. If you could be good enough to mute, if you're not speaking, it would help us. We're getting a bunch of background noise today. I'm not quite sure from where, but it would help us if you could mute. I found it. I found the background noise, and it's somebody I'm not sure who it is, so I've muted them. I will unmute momentarily if I haven't identified you. Okay, so here's who I know is on the call right now. Skip Maniscalco, Jake Hannum, Jim Harrington, Dennis Correa, Jay Curran, Steve Bornstein, Frank Kelly, Larry Fish, Len Sierra, Peter Kafka, Steve Korn, Sylvester Mann, Mike Tamales, Paul Frieda, Jim Cameron, Tito Lincecum, Bill Franklin. Is there anyone who I have not, whose name I have not called?
She wants my name tomorrow.
Who was that?
Eric Bookbinder.
$70 tomorrow. We're not going till May.
Eric Bookbinder.
Yeah.
And
well, she didn't send a message to me.
And we've got somebody who hasn't identified who's having a little conversation there. Could you tell us who you are? No.
I gave you your answer.
There you go.
I think it's Peter Kafka.
Well, whoever it is, they're muted, and I'm sorry, I've muted caller number 15. I don't quite know who it is, but I'll try unmuting you in a moment when we go through to see who has something to talk about today. So let me run down the list and see who has something they'd like to speak about. Skip. Did you want to just mention your results or get any input? Skip? You may be muted. No? Okay, we'll come back to Skip. Jake, anything for you?
You talking to Frank?
I'm talking to Jake.
No, Rick. I took up enough time last time.
You never take up enough time, Jake. What do you do for us, believe me. Jim, anything else for you today?
No, I think I've had my moment and nothing. Thanks.
Dennis Correa, how about yourself?
No, nothing here, Rick. Thank you.
Jay Bob?
I want to ask about taking bone stiffeners when you're on Lupron. Forget the name of them. Go ahead.
We'll come back to you, Jay. I got you. Steve Bornstein, anything for you?
Well, if you have time, Rick, I'm starting back on acupuncture for the peripheral neuropathy.
Okay.
Just wondering if I had any other experiences with it. So neuropathy has persisted, gotten worse.
Yep. Frank Kelly, how about yourself?
Yeah, I've probably got something on drug interaction and high blood pressure.
Okay.
Might be interesting.
Yep. Larry Fish, how about you? Larry? Anything for you? Okay. Len? Anything
for you? Nothing for me, Rick.
Nope. Peter Kafka, are you with us?
Yes, I am. I'm good tonight.
Thanks. Steve Korn, you want to give us a little, we haven't heard from you for a while. You want to just give us a little update on all of your treatment?
Sure. Thank you, Rick. Quick update. This is Steve Korn, based in New York. I'm being treated at Memorial Sloan Kettering.
Steve, I'll come back to you. I'm just planning
okay.
time. So I'll just...
Okay, got it. Yep, got
I'll
it.
Come back to you. Sylvester, anything for you tonight?
Not this evening, thank you.
Okay. Mike Tamales, you want to let us know what's going on out there in Maui and tell us about your new doc?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, I'll be back to you. Paul, anything for you? Paul Frieda. Paul? Okay. Jim Cameron, anything for you?
No, not tonight, Rick.
Okay. Thibaut, you need to fill us in on how you're doing because we haven't heard from you for so long.
Yeah, I got a couple things to talk about.
Okay. Are you going to be with us the whole call or not?
I will try.
Okay. All right. Maybe I'll bump you up because I know you've got the kids and they sometimes pull you away.
Yeah.
I know. Bill Franklin, anything for you?
Well, I'm just listening tonight, Rick. Appreciate it.
And Eric, how about yourself?
No, I don't have anything new.
Okay. And caller number 15. Whoever the unidentified caller is there anything you'd like to raise? No? Okay. So I think I've gotten everybody. Skip, are you back with us?
Yes, I am. You were right. I did have my phone on mute, and I was talking, and I was wondering why nobody responded.
Oh, okay. Well, now you know. So would you like a little bit of time to just talk about what your PSA is doing?
Yeah, that would be fine, but probably more to the point, I'd like to understand what is meant by the term castrate resistance. How do you spot it? And how does it manifest itself? Okay. I presume you monitor in PSA, and what causes it?
Okay. So, yeah, we can definitely talk about that. So we've got just a little over an hour, so hopefully we'll get around to most of you. I may jump around a little bit today because I think there's a couple of important things that we should follow up with.
Testing.
So I'm going to have to mute 15 again. Sorry. Whoever it is that isn't identifying 15, I'm going to mute you. So I'll try you. You know, if you'd like to identify, now's your opportunity. If there's anything you want to talk about, tell us now because we're getting background noise from you.
Rick, Larry Fish was trying to talk a minute ago.
Okay. Larry.
You called on him.
Yep. Larry, I called on you and I didn't hear you. Was there anything you wanted to raise tonight? Larry?
Again, can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you now.
You can hear me now.
Yes, we can.
Okay. One of the things I wanted to mention is I had a visit with my consulting and co-
I'll come back to you. I just
okay, I'll come back. Yeah.
Just planning
good.
Time. Okay. Thanks.
Thanks.
Okay. So I think let's just start and just take 5 minutes or so to talk about Skip's question, because it is a good question. It actually has come up myself just recently in trying to help some people identify trial participants. And the question is, what does castrate-resistant prostate cancer actually mean? How do you know when you're castrate-resistant? What were the other questions you had about it, Skip?
What causes it?
What causes it?
And what drug is it that you become resistant to? I don't know if it's the Lupron or the Casodex or Xtandi or...
Well, let me give you my understanding very briefly, and then I'm going to throw it open and let some other people chip in on this. And only because I've been thinking about it in the context of this woman that's been looking for castrate-resistant participants in her market research study. And what I believe is that castrate-resistant prostate cancer refers only to certain drugs. It means that your PSA and the cancer are not responding to the LHRH drugs, the LHRH family of drugs, both the agonists and the antagonists. So that would include Lupron, Firmagon, Zoladex, Eligard. I've missed out a bunch, but there's probably six or seven of them. But you all know what they are. They're the drugs that drive all of you taking them absolutely nuts.
When you go up, I'll...
and also first line antiandrogens like Casodex, bicalutamide. I forget there was another one that used to be given before bicalutamide. I can't even remember the name of it now. Nilutamide is another one, but there's a bunch of those drugs. If you don't respond to those drugs, your PSA increases, the usual heuristic measure is it goes up three successive times. Although nobody ever talks about what the intervals are, but if you see three successive rises in your PSA, then you're considered to be castrate resistant, meaning that you don't respond to the LHRH drugs and you don't respond to the first line antiandrogen. And essentially what's happening is that the cancer is sensitizing itself to these drugs, and it's able to survive and to grow on a lot less testosterone than it was previously. So the first line antiandrogens may not completely block the androgen receptors, so some of the receptors may become a little more capable of finding testosterone. You don't have much testosterone. But the cancer finds a way to use what it's got, what's available to it, and may start to manufacture it itself. I mean, it sounds pretty incredible, but the...
So it's...
Hold on a second, Skip. It sounds pretty incredible, okay. But the cancer has the ability to take other... proteins in your body or other elements. I'm not sure if cholesterol is considered to be a protein or not, but it takes other things in your body like cholesterol, and it can break it down and extract out of the cholesterol testosterone, because testosterone is also a base element for cholesterol. And so these second line drugs that we use, particularly Zytiga, for example, abiraterone, prevents the cancer from breaking down other elements to get to the testosterone. So very briefly, that's my understanding of castrate-resistant prostate cancer. Skip, let me come back to you, and then let me throw it open.
Okay. No, I was going to ask. So it sounds like it's the antagonist. Is it the casodexin, the Xtandi, and the Zytiga is the one that stops the work, because the Lupron just slows or eliminates the production of testosterone by the testes, right?
Not really. I mean, what's happening is, first of all, at least to this point in time, abiraterone, Zytiga is not included in defining castrate resistance, largely because I don't think there have been enough trials using it early on. So we're really, when we talk about castrate resistance, because that becomes quite an important factor for some of these later drugs, certainly as far as the insurance companies are concerned, they won't put you on drugs until you're castrate resistant. We're really only talking about first line antiandrogens, which are Casodex, or the one that preceded Casodex, whose name I forget now. It was a drug I was given, so I can't even remember it. Or the LHRH drugs. Now, the LHRH drugs continue to work, but they don't do enough to stop the cancer increasing, growing. It isn't that these drugs don't work, it's that they are ineffective. They don't do enough to stop the cancer growing. So yes, the LHRH drugs continue to reduce your testosterone. That's why you have to keep taking them even when you're on advanced treatments, because they still reduce the amount of testosterone in your body, which is important when you're taking the more advanced drugs, so that they don't get swamped with testosterone. Now, we're not gonna fall into the bipolar androgen treatment discussion here, because maybe there is a role for getting a lot of testosterone in your body, but by and large, for most treatments, we want to keep the testosterone very low. Does that explain that, Skip?
No, that does. No, I understand.
Okay. Let me throw it open.
That's very helpful.
Let me throw it open to anybody else who'd like to talk about castrate resistance.
I believe you're right, Rick. This is Jake. Three consecutive PSA rises and testosterone at a level of 50 or below is my understanding of the definition.
But only whilst on certain drugs.
While on the LHRH, correct.
Right, LHRH and Casodex. I think Casodex is included.
I don't know about the Casodex, but definitely on the LHRH.
The reason I say Casodex is because I know a lot of guys that have been on double blockade, which is LHRH plus Casodex, bicalutamide. Sorry, guys. Let me get rid of that. I know a lot of guys who have been on both those drugs and then are considered castrate resistant when their PSA starts to rise. So that's the only reason I included. For Provenge, for example, it seems to be included.
I certainly fall into that category.
Is Lupron an LHRH drug?
Yes, it is. Steve, you wanted to say something?
No, I mean, there's antagonists and agonists. That's too confusing, right, though, Rick. I think, for all intents and purposes, they all are LHRH drugs, yes.
Yeah, Len, thank you. Len reminds me it's flutamide. Flutamide was the one that was before bicalutamide. What was the name of What was the commercial name of flutamide? I think it began with a P, didn't it, Len?
I don't remember that.
Okay, but that's what they gave us before. Before the bicalutamide went generic, that's what they used to give us before we started taking Lupron, was the flutamide. That's right. Anything else, or can we move on?
One last question.
Yep.
If you're determined to be castrate resistant on Casodex, does that preclude any purpose to going further with Xtandi or Zytiga?
No. First of all, Casodex is a strange drug because there are people, we've discussed this often on this call, but sometimes when you appear to be castrate resistant, you can stop the Casodex if you've been on double blockade, and your PSA for some percentage of men, what's the percentage, Jake? You know that.
Approximately 30%.
Yeah, that's right. So about 30% of men see a drop in their PSA when they stop the Casodex. And that may last for 3-6 months, at which point they become really properly castrate resistant. And that's when they generally will progress to one of the second line drugs. In the old days, it used to be ketoconazole that was the drug of choice. Now it is either abiraterone or enzalutamide, Zytiga or Xtandi. Xtandi is kind of ketoconazole on steroids. It works much the same way as ketoconazole, but ketoconazole is, I never see it used anymore. I haven't heard it being used since about 2010, 11, sometime around then. But I remember when Xtandi was in trials, we had guys that were on ketoconazole and they were excluded from the Xtandi trials, but they could participate in the abiraterone trial. Mm-hmm. All right, go ahead.
Thank you.
Sure. Okay, I'm going to move on. Jay, what was your, well, oh no, let me skip to Thibaut because I know he's got little kids and he sometimes gets called away. Thibaut, why don't you just give us an update as to where you are and tell us what's on your mind?
Well, I also have signed up for a new and risky clinical trial. I learned about it on this phone call a while back when Dr. Denmead was telling about his bipolar androgen therapy trials. I was disappointed to find out they didn't have an opening for a guy like me
right
in those trials, but then I was happy to learn that he was also doing this new trial that I seem to be eligible for. It involves a bone marrow transplant.
Wow.
And it's different from bone marrow transplants have been used for prostate cancer a long time ago, and they didn't work very well. They were basically trying to do the same thing they've done for leukemia and other cancers, whereas they, you know, give you a massive dose of chemo, hoping that will kill the cancer. And then afterwards, you get your bone marrow transplant to restore your destroyed immune system. But this is different. They give a small dose of chemo just to facilitate the transplant so your old immune system doesn't kill the new one. And then they hope that the new immune system will fight the cancer. And it has to be a female relative. They're thinking that a female immune system is more likely to see prostate material as weird and attack it. And then they also follow up the transplant with the super physiologic testosterone, just like in the bipolar androgen therapy. And you go back and forth for a few months between high and low testosterone. And I guess that is to either kill the cancer or make the cancer grow such that the new immune system recognizes it. Neither one is potentially a good thing. And today was a big day because my insurance company said yes, they would pay for it.
Wow. Fantastic.
And, Johns Hopkins charges a flat $150,000 for a bone marrow transplant. So they're going to pay for that because there's no research budget for this. And so I still haven't talked to the bone marrow transplant team about all the details, but I think I'll be, you know, in the hospital for a week or so, and then I'll have to keep going back to the hospital 3 times a week for a few months. So I'll be applying for at least short-term disability and not working during that time. And there's about a, you know, historically, leukemia patients getting bone marrow transplants have a 5 to 10% chance of dying from the process.
Right.
And they don't have, you know, any statistics from prostate cancer people doing it because nobody's done it yet. I would potentially be number one in this phase one trial.
Wow. Now, was this...
Dr. Denmead says I'm going to be Buzz Aldrin.
So have you sort of switched from Antonakis to Denmead now at Johns Hopkins?
Well, not officially. I mean, yeah, I'll probably see Denmead more often if I'm in his trial.
Right.
You know, I'm supposed to see Antonakis every now and then as follow-ups to the two clinical trials I did with him in the past.
Right.
And he will remain, you know, available if I want to send him an email or see him.
Now, let me ask you, the Alliance trial with, was it ever unblinded to you? Do you know whether you were getting enzalutamide or abiraterone or both?
Oh, it was not blinded. I was only getting Xtandi.
Okay. And then that stopped working. Your PSA started to rise back in November, right?
September. Yeah, I started in March, just about 1 year ago,
right,
on Xtandi. And then it took my PSA down from 20 to 7, and then it started going up. And the doubling time has been about 2 months.
Mm-hmm.
And it's now up to at least 32. I don't know exactly. A month ago it was 32.
Have you had your tumor sequenced or not?
No, I only had you know, I tested my normal cells and they through the color genomics, and they didn't find any known mutations.
Mm-hmm.
Out of the 30 that they look for.
Right. You know, maybe you could, in all of this, maybe you could twist Hopkins' arm and see if they can sequence your tumor as well, because that would be really good information for you.
You know, yeah, but...
Find out if you're eligible for, or if you've got a gene that might be actionable. I mean, I'm not saying instead of, but I think it would be good information.
Yeah, I've probably got some tumors that are big enough. Yeah, I should bring that up. And another complication is about 10 days ago,
yeah,
I started having a new pain in my upper back.
Mm.
And I've never had pain from bone metastases before, but I'm suspecting that's what this is.
Mm.
And it started out like right at the center at the spine,
mm-hmm,
below my neck, at the, you know, in between my shoulder blades. Mm-hmm. And then, but then it was mild for the first few days, but then it was really bad one day at work, and I such that I
I couldn't work for a few hours until I took a couple of Vicodin that I had left over from physical therapy a year before. And then after that, it seemed like it was a little left of the spine. And then the last couple of days, it feels like it's like near my left scapula, shoulder blade. I don't understand how it's moving. And even though it feels pretty much the same, it's just the place that I feel it's different. And I'm not sure how to determine whether it's bone metastases or something else.
So let me throw that open to some of the guys who are have some experience with bone pain. Can you, any pointers, any help, any thoughts for Tebow? Any of you gents?
Well, I could add one thing. During this process I was going to talk about, I get headaches, and they seem to move around. They aren't like real headaches where they stick to one place. And it just seems to move around the head minute by minute, and I wake up with them.
But go ahead.
This is Jake. I also have, I have bone mets in my spine and my iliac wings and my sacrum and everything. And I have constant lower back pain, but I also get occasional pains that move around like you described. You know, one day my rib hurts, the next day I have a pain in my back, another time I have a pain in my hip, but they're not constant or consistent. And my oncologist says that cancer pain is pretty much steady. Though she thinks it's something else, you know, it could be posture, it could be, you know, sleeping wrong or whatever. She says if it's steady, it's probably cancer. If it's not steady, it's probably not. Even though the spine can obviously refer, you know, spine meds can obviously refer pain throughout your body. So that's, you know, for what it's worth.
I think that's promising, because I know that for the bipolar androgen therapy, they weren't allowing people with bone metastases pain, because sometimes the big dose of testosterone makes your pain go up by a bunch.
I think anybody our collective ages has pain. I mean, musculoskeletal pain is so common, and I think the comment that, you know, if it's persistent and it's not relieved by small doses of ibuprofen and that type of thing, you know, whether it's cancer pain or whether it's just an aching pain because we're old guys, you know, I don't know. I mean, it's hard to, I don't think there's anybody 68, which is what I am, is pain free. You know, I don't know anyone that is.
Well, I'm only 45.
Steve. Yeah. But even then, I remember when I was 45, I used to get shoulder pain, and, you know, I used to get injected a number of times, and, you know, leg pain because I used to be a runner, and, you know, it doesn't really matter the age. Musculoskeletal pain, especially from weekend athletes, is just really common.
Well, having,
maybe it'll go away.
Or hopefully. In your case, having the kids jump all over you, which is equivalent.
That doesn't.
Yeah, I do. I do get attacked quite often by some 3 feet tall savages.
Let me just go back to this trial a second and just make sure I understand it. So the trial is going to include a bone marrow transplant from a female relative, and then followed by an infusion of a large amount of testosterone. And then how often, is that just a one time, or do they repeat this, or?
That's once a month for at least 3 months.
Okay.
I don't know exactly how they decide to stop that.
Okay. And so the transplant also happened on 3 different occasions, as well as the testosterone infusion.
No. The transplant's a one-time thing.
The transplant's a one-time thing, but the infusion goes on for is repeated three times.
Okay. Right.
And is there any what drugs are you on? What type of hormone therapy drugs are you on throughout this with the whilst you're going through the infusion of testosterone?
Yeah, the ADT that I'm on now, the regular LHRH, I would continue. In my case, that's Zoladex.
Right.
And I would stay on that. But they want me to stop the Xtandi like a month before the transplant.
Okay. So nothing. So the no other drugs are involved in this at all?
Well, they use some chemotherapy drugs to, affect the functioning of the immune system to facilitate the transplant.
Okay. Anybody have? Would anybody else like to speak to Thibault about this trial or anything else that he said?
Rick, I'd like to know what the scientific rationale is for a bone marrow transplant for prostate cancer. Thibault, did they explain that to you?
I will get busy with my little black pen.
Well, in general, everybody gets cancer, but most people's immune systems kill it before it becomes significant. If you've got major cancer, that means something's wrong with your immune system. So, the idea is to, throw in a new immune system and see if that one works like most people do, I guess. Yeah, I'm not an expert. I don't know.
Well,
but, it's Johns Hopkins, and I figure, if all of their review boards have approved it, there must be something to it.
Yep.
Makes sense. It's the first I've ever heard of it, but it certainly makes sense.
Yeah, my concern is like Len's. I think that it makes a lot of sense for, tumor like multiple myeloma or leukemias or other treatments that involve, basically blood-borne cancers, but the prostate cancer is in your bone. I guess the rationale is that it's really sort of refreshing your immune system. I don't know. I mean, it's a... The only thing is, bone marrow transplant is risky business, and
well, they're going to be using both chemo and total body radiation to weaken my existing immune system.
Yeah, they wipe it out.
Well,
do they physically remove the old bone marrow before they replace it with a new bone marrow? I mean, do they go in and scrape it out or something?
No.
Now they just treat it with chemo and radiation.
So they basically permanently kill your bone marrow. And that's what makes it risky because, you obviously are at risk for infection at that point.
Right.
So it's not a physical screen.
I don't think they can completely kill it, but they weaken it enough that the new immune system that will finish up the job. Occasionally, a new immune system doesn't take, and it's possible for your old immune system to, grow again, and you end up where you started.
So, with a bit of luck, first of all, I do hope you'll come back and tell us how you're doing, Thibault, or at least send me a note so I can tell the guys, but we love to have you back and to hear from you. We all pray this is going to work. And, with a bit of luck, we can possibly get Dr. Demme to come on and talk to us again about the trial as he recruits more people and he sees where it's going. So... by the way, if you happen to talk to Dr. Demmead in the next couple of days, I need to send him a note, but I just found out today that our recording of the bipolar androgen therapy talk that he gave has been closed captioned. which is really great.
Cool.
Just let him know in case he wants to pass it on to anybody that has a disability that the recording is now closed captioned. So
is that in that Jim 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 video or somebody else did it?
It was one of Jim one of Jim Marshall's cohorts that closed captioned it, which was really great. I saw it this morning and I was just blown away, and I sent Jim a little note and thanked him, and so I think that's just great for people that can't otherwise listen to it. It may be helpful for him to know that too. I do plan to send him a note, but you may talk to him before he sees my note. So we'd love to spend more time, but we need to move on because the sand is slipping through the hourglass.
Rick.
Yeah.
Before you go on, are you aware that you're sharing your screen and we can see what you're typing?
Oh no. Thanks.
Yeah, okay. I sent you a note there, Rick. You didn't see it.
No. I sent you a note too.
Okay. Thanks. I'll stop sharing my screen.
There you go. Now we see two scruffy bearded guys.
Yeah, that's it. That's us. He's more scruffy than me.
Oh. So now everybody gets to see my secrets, how I managed to know where you all are. I keep notes.
Yeah, if you ever lost your contact list, you'd be what they call screwed.
Fortunately.
Or if somebody hacks into your Gmail file, we'd all be screwed.
That's right. Yeah. Hack into my Gmail.
Like Hillary Clinton over there, you know? Yeah. Private server.
So let's keep moving along here. Jay, what was your you had a concern about the bone strengthening drugs, Zometa and Xgeva. What exactly can we tell you about them?
I've been on Lupron since November 1st. I talked to him with Dr. Ryan at UCSF. Talked to his nurse practitioner about 2 weeks ago, and I said, well, could I get those two drugs? And she said, I don't think it's appropriate.
Mm-hmm. So you're wondering what are the criteria for taking one of those drugs? Is that right?
Yep.
So again, let me tell you what I know, and then we'll open it up. If you have identifiable bone mets, then it's highly recommended that you do go on these drugs, and you do. You have bone mets to the pelvis, to the hips, and the skull. So it's not clear to me why they wouldn't be giving you Lupron why they wouldn't be giving you Zometa or Xgeva. Was it Nurse Ratchet that that said to you no?
Yeah.
It was.
She also said that bone density tests were inappropriate. Not inappropriate, but... you can't learn anything from them.
Well, the bone density tests are important because if you happen to be osteoporotic when you start on Lupron, then there are certain steps that should be taken, including giving you a bone strengthener. That was my own situation. So even though I didn't have bone mets, I was borderline osteoporotic, and so they gave me shots. They gave me Zometa three times over a period of 3 years, 2.5 years. Now, my strong recommendation to anybody, and this is as an advocate, I'm speaking as an advocate. My strong recommendation to anybody that attends UCSF is not to take an appointment with this woman. because I've seen her screw up too many times. And anybody that asks me for my advice, I tell them, refuse the appointment. There is another very, very good nurse practitioner there. I forget her name, but everybody I've known and seen her has said that she is excellent. But I would not see Rod Feld for all the tea in China.
Okay.
And frankly, what you should do, what I would do is I would write a note to Chuck Ryan and say, I have bone mets. And my understanding of the protocol is that Zometa is now administered. It's not administered as frequently as it used to be, or it shouldn't be. They used to give it once every 6 weeks. We now seem to think that it isn't needed more than once every 3 months, and maybe even less than that. We don't know. But once every 3 months seems to be as good as once every 6 weeks. I can't talk to you about Xgeva. It works a different way. It's an antibody, and I don't know. I don't understand how it works. But I can say that for most men who have bone mets, but there's very good reason for them to be getting a bisphosphonate or Xgeva. And the problem, of course, is that your emails to Ryan get intercepted by the nurse practitioners. But I also think it should be documented. If it were me, I would want it documented. And then next time when you see Ryan, you can discuss it with him directly. But I mean, I'm not giving you medical advice. I'm telling you what the protocol is. And I'm also telling you from experience what my experience with Nurse Ratched is. And I've told you before. So that I'm putting it pretty bluntly, and I don't mind being on public record on that. And she knows it anyway, so there's no difference. Anybody else want to chip in on?
Well, I take Xgeva, which is denosumab. It does work differently, but it basically does the same thing. I didn't take it for, it was probably over a year after I started hormone or androgen deprivation therapy, and actually was with Rick's urging that I mentioned it to my oncologist, who said, oh, I sort of forgot about it, you know. And so it's given monthly by self-injection, and like an insulin injection, you just give it into the abdomen, the fat, sub-Q fat. So I give it myself, and looking at the studies that were done, it clearly improves both long-term outcome and skeletal-related events, in other words, fractures and so on, in the presence of metastatic prostate cancer of the bone. So I would say you should be on one of them also, and I've done a lot of reading about this. I preferred the Xgeva because I felt it had less side effects, and I can give it myself. So, you know, but it's a 6-1, you know.
You don't have to give it yourself, by the way.
No, you don't have to. They can give it for you. No.
Steve gives it himself because he's a doc. His wife's a nurse, so it's easy for them to do it. But most people will get it in a hospital setting, but it's very easy.
It's simple. Yeah, actually, Maureen, my wife, gave the first couple, but then I realized that it's easier just to give it myself with all the drama and so on when she gives it some. So that's what I've been doing for about 6-8 months now, I think.
Rick, this is Peter. I just want to speak about non-metastatic. I mean, my oncologist was very proactive, and as soon as I went on ADT, he started giving me Prolia shots every 6 months, and I did have a bone density test, because anybody who's going to have radiation or ADT, there's a definite chance that your bones are going to suffer, and you need to keep them strong.
Well, Prolia is actually the same as Xgeva. It's right. Denosumab. There's two different labels. One's for breast cancer, one's for prostate. You're on the one for breast cancer, Prolia, but it's the same drug.
I think isn't the dosage different, though, Steve? Doesn't Prolia last longer?
No, it's actually it's given less frequently, Prolia, but it's denosumab. It's the same drug.
Right.
And
right.
So it doesn't matter as long as you're taking the same dose regimen that they recommend.
Yeah, I mean, it's standard protocol that they measure your bone density when you go on long-term hormone therapy. If they are going to put you on hormone therapy for more than 12 months, you're supposed to get a bone density test. Exactly for the reason that I got it, because even though I didn't have bone mets, my bone density was already poor. So they were able to take measures. So when Nurse Ratchet says, oh, you don't need it and it doesn't mean anything, I mean, I guess what she's saying is you already have bone mets, so we already know that you need some sort of bone strengthener, but then she's not giving it to you. I mean, if she said you don't need it, we'll give you the bone strengthener, it would make sense to me. If she said you don't need the bone strengthener and you don't need a bone density test, I don't get that.
Well, Rick?
Yeah.
It also gives you a timeline for later tests to see whether or not you're losing more bone structure or not, too.
Absolutely. Yeah, I mean, that's a good point. Yeah, it does. It's a baseline. You're absolutely right, Frank. But, Bob, I just think you need to push that. If you want to talk to me offline about it, I'm happy to do it. But you have to be proactive and you have to take charge of this yourself. She's not giving you good advice, and it happens with that particular practitioner. And there are other practitioners that I avoid at UCSF. I don't need to name them unless their names come up. I've already mentioned that to you. I would not take an appointment.
I'll give you a call offline, or I'll send you an email.
There was the clinical trial. I forget what the name of it was. It was very clear that it provided a long-term benefit in the presence of bone metastases. So, I mean, you can actually, this is kind of a no-brainer, you know what I mean? It's not like controversial at this point. I think everybody that treats this is supposed to just be doing it. Interestingly, my two oncologists at Kaiser, the main one said, oh, yeah, I should have put you on this. I kind of forgot. I mean, it's interesting, you know, you kind of have to be your own advocate sometimes, I think.
It's good we kept reminding him. the Dr. S, that is. All right, guys, I'm gonna move along just because I really would like to try and get to everybody tonight if we can possibly do that.
Rick, could I just add one item here on this issue I was talking about?
Yeah.
I am taking a supplement. It's a combination vitamin D, 1,000 international units, vitamin K, calcium, 500 milligrams, magnesium, and strontium, the boron combination.
Mm-hmm.
And I take four of these a day. This was recommended by my urologist when I first started with the with him, and knowing that I was going to be getting the treatment.
Well, so, Dennis, the only thing I would say for others is that just make sure you know your levels, because there's nothing wrong with taking D. There's nothing wrong with taking calcium. I don't know anything about K. Steve can fill us in about that momentarily. But I do know that both with D and with calcium, you do need to know your levels first. If your vitamin D level is up in the 40s already, you don't need it. Some people like myself make too much calcium, and I don't need more calcium in my body. And there's nothing wrong with supplements. Most of you know that I'm in big favor of complementary medicine, but two things. One, always discuss supplements with your doctor, with your Western doctor, your Western medicine doctor, to make sure that there's no interactions with any other drugs. And two, it's strongly advisable to test for those supplements before you take them. For example, selenium or vitamin E can be harmful if you're already at a normal level. And so you just need to know your levels before you take them. Steve, did you want to say anything about that, or Kay?
Well, just, you know, the magnesium and calcium and vitamin D are all important in reasonable dosage. On these drugs, especially denosumab, Xgeva, they tend to cause your calcium to drop. And so you have to really monitor the calcium. They like you to do calciums before the injection each time, just in case it's too low. So you do definitely want to take calcium supplementation if you go on these bone strengthening drugs, any of them. But you know, as far as taking, you know, K and other vitamins, you know, I'm no expert. I know you can certainly overdose yourself if you go too far on it. But I also, you know, I take calcium, magnesium, and D, and so on. So, and I haven't had my calcium measured. I don't do it every month anymore, but I do it, you know, periodically when I do a blood test, and want to make sure it's over 9, it should be 9.5 in that range before you give the Xgeva injection.
Okay, let's move on. Frank, you're up. Oh, wait a minute. I may have, we may, hold on, Frank. We were getting.
Yes, I'm here.
Yeah, you're here. Okay, we want to make sure we hadn't muted you. Go ahead.
Well, you know, I had a blood pressure problem.
Yes.
And we couldn't get into my honk. And so we farted around for a while and just, I got into my nephrologist, and she upped my level of my high blood pressure medicine by 50%. And that was it. And then I finally got to see my onc, and he said, well, that could be the prednisone. And from what I gather, most chemo is given with prednisone. And he dropped the chemo, too, for the time being, the cabazitaxel.
Yep.
And, but it was working real well. I wound up going from 6.5 to 1.4 in about 2 months, 3 months. So I don't know what's going to happen. He's giving me a month off. But I walked into my pharmacist. He said, well, duh, prednisone tends to make the kidneys absorb more salt. And that was the problem. So they've got me on all kinds of drugs. My wife's working on counter effects of each drug with each other. And we're going to talk to the pharmacist and go back to the onc next week. Actually, we're meeting with a new onc to see, because I wasn't too impressed the fact that they took a week plus to get a hold of me. And you guys were saying it was kind of a crisis with my blood pressure reading over 200. It's now come down to about 140, 136, something like that. But the lower number keeps hanging around 200. Now, I don't know whether prednisone has a lasting effect on you. I was taking 10 milligrams a day. But that was, and my wife did do some research and found out there's a lot of cross side effects between some of the stuff that I'm on. And if some of you guys are on chemo, you might do a little blood pressure testing just to make sure that prednisone is not doing something to your kidneys.
Okay. Frank, just a couple of things. You said your lower number is at 200 or 100?
It's just around 100. It might be 92.
Okay. I thought you'd said 200, and I was going to say, geez, that's So you're like about somewhere around like 135 to 140
over,
or 92.
Over like 92 or 96 or something like that.
I mean, the only thing I would say to you, again, this is just from knowing other men, is that when they came off the prednisone, they needed to titrate off of it, meaning come off of it slowly. Because
yep, I did that already. Yes,
okay.
I've done that already.
Okay, so you can't stop dead.
Went for 5 days on half dose and then cut it out.
Okay, because I know men who came off of it dead and came off of it immediately, and it just, one of them lost 30 pounds on that. So you just have to be careful. I mean, I'm just really disappointed that the your medonc took so long to get back to you, because, you know.
Well, another thing about this is that he said, we said, well, I should have come off prednisone slowly. He said, well, till 10 milligrams a day, that won't make any difference. Just go ahead and stop it. And my wife and I decided, because of the protocols we were reading, to go ahead and continue half dose for 5 days and then cut it out completely. So that, yeah, I'm not too impressed with my medical team now. This is my new onc. Yeah. I've only met him twice. Young guy. Looks like he looks in the mirror all the time, cowboy boots, a Yahoo type thing. And that's why we're meeting with a new guy on Wednesday, Thursday. at a different outfit close by. And they were
cowboy boots, different outfit.
I'm giving you about what the guy looks like. He looks in the mirror more than anything else. But anyway, we're disappointed with him. And my wife even talked to his nurse and all this other stuff, and nobody could get back to us until we went in for an appointment a week later. And I'm unimpressed with the fact that he said, just take you off prednisone right off the bat. Something's going on here that isn't right.
So I have a thought to discuss with either this medonc or the new medonc, and then I would agree with you. I mean, just the fact that you have a medical emergency and you can't get hold of your medical oncologist for over a week is would be very, very worrying to me. And I know you tried really hard to get him. God knows how many times you called him. But one thing that I'm just wondering is, and I don't know this, I'm wondering if different steroids can work in different ways and whether there would be a different steroid other than prednisone that you might be able to use to accompany your next Jeptana dose when you go back on it?
Well, one of my questions is, what does prednisone do for you?
Steve, I know you. Go ahead.
Well, it basically is used in that setting to suppress any allergic reactions that you have. They usually use either betamethasone, dexamethasone, which are much more potent per milligram, for only a few days around the time of the chemo. You were taking the prednisone all the time or just around the time of the chemo?
No, all the time.
Yeah, I've never been on Jeptana, so I don't know what the protocol is there. But typically, with docetaxel, they use, dexamethasone in small dosages just the day before and a couple days after, and that's to prevent any allergic response that you might have.
Okay, well, my first oncologist is the one that put me on prednisone, day after day after day when I was on.
Yeah, 10 milligrams is a pretty small dose of prednisone. That's not, you don't forget, for poison, oak, we typically use 60 milligrams of prednisone for a week and then taper it slowly. So 10 milligrams is a pretty small dose. I mean, it's not like it's a lot, but it certainly can cause you to retain sodium and raise your blood pressure, and so on. Any steroid can do that.
Steve, what is the, I'm having a senior moment, what is the gland that produces
adrenal gland.
Adrenal.
It produces aldosterone is the hormone. Right. And that is very critical in terms of producing, there's something called a renin-angiotensin axis. I mean, it's right. Complicated, not worth talking about, but that has a lot of the various antihypertensives use that adrenal renal axis to work. Cozar, for example, is one of them. An anti-angiotensin drugs, they call them. Anyway, but prednisone and other steroids have the effect of causing salt retention, and that's the mechanism usually for the hypertension.
Yeah, I mean, what I was going to say is that a lot of these drugs suppress the adrenal glands, and so my understanding also, other than the allergic reaction, was that they would give you the prednisone to keep your adrenal gland functioning at a fairly normal level.
Continuously. I don't know. I'm not really sure why they would give it continuously for intermittent chemotherapy. Not really sure. I certainly they don't do it for docetaxel, and I don't know that they do it for other chemotherapeutics like the platinum-based ones. We certainly didn't do it when I was using those. So I don't know why they would do it continuously like that. And 10 milligrams is a low dose, though,
I've known guys that have been on prednisone right the way through their docetaxel. They get dexamethasone right around, and then they're on low-dose prednisone the whole time. I've known several guys. Yeah. Anybody here who's been on, other than Steve, been on docetaxel and taken prednisone?
Yeah, this is Skip. I was on docetaxel, and I took the prednisone the day before and the day after the docetaxel cycle, and then during the day of the docetaxel cycle, they gave me an infusion of prednisone.
Yeah.
But you didn't. I don't know. I don't recall the amounts that I was given, but.
Let me tell you.
Kathy's here, and she knows the amount in the
pill. Yeah. No, I mean at UCSF they give you dexamethasone before.
Right, that's what it was. Dexamethasone, four milligrams.
They give you
one or two milligrams
before the day of and the day after, and then they have you on prednisone, low dose prednisone all the time. You're on the chemo.
No, that wasn't in my case.
Yeah, not Steve's either. So I don't know.
I don't know.
That was the same thing for me too. This is Dennis.
Okay, just you didn't take low dose prednisone throughout?
No.
Yeah, I mean, the guys that I know at UCSF were taking, a 5 milligram. They take 5 milligrams right the way through their chemo cycles on a daily basis. Because the guy I know who came off of it, that was the whole problem. He stopped it, and he was taking it daily.
Yeah, prednisone has a lot of side effects given chronically. I mean, and so, you know, I don't know. I mean, I guess there's certain protocols that you can use. But before I did the docetaxel, I did quite a bit of reading, and I didn't read anywhere where continuous dose prednisone was something that was talked about. So I don't know.
Frank, did you take prednisone when you were on docetaxel? What was your prednisone regime?
Yes.
You were taking it all the time, right? Or not?
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep. Same with the the other taxol that they had me on it the whole time.
Right.
Even when I went on a break for 6 weeks, he had me stay on it until I started up the chemo again.
Yeah.
Well, obviously, guys, there's different protocols, but Frank, I don't know enough about this by a long stretch, but I'm just wondering whether there are any other drugs that can do the same thing the prednisone would do that might not have that same effect on your blood pressure, if there are any alternative drugs. And that's the question I would ask your medical oncologist.
Well, I think that's a good question, because I should stay on the docetaxel because I'm having such good luck with it.
Cabazitaxel.
Yeah, that's the first time I've seen my PSA drop like that, everything I've been on.
Well, that's
So I think the question is, can you take it just around the time of the administration of the cabazitaxel and not continuously? That would probably solve the problem.
Right. That's another good, you know, those are two strategies. Steve's strategy, just taking some steroids right around it, or something other than prednisone.
Rick, this is Eric. You know, when I was on docetaxel, I had the prednisone every day except around the times of administration, and then I got dexamethasone.
Right.
I took that for 3 days.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Day before, day of, and day after, and the rest of the time I took prednisone.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. That's the protocol I'm more familiar with, but evidently there are alternative protocols. Maybe they give you some sort of prednisone infusion at the same time, which is sufficient to keep you going. I have no idea. I don't know, but yeah.
That's what they give me, an infusion just before they give me the docetaxel infusion.
Yeah,
and
that's...
They did the same thing with the other taxol, was an infusion which had prednisone in it.
Right.
Yeah, they have. It's called solumedrol. It's actually not prednisone. Prednisone only comes as a pill. But
Okay.
That's a good thought, to make sure that my new or my old oncologist has a heads up on it. Yes.
Yeah. Two things to tell Lisa, or if Lisa's listening in. One, maybe you can just take it right around on this type of protocol that Steve and some others have used, instead of the one like Eric was on. And then the other is there an alternative type of steroid that would have the same effect but might not work on the kidneys the same way that the prednisone does? I'm gonna move along.
Thanks, Rick.
Steve Korn, go ahead. We haven't heard from you for a long time, so I want to be sure to get to you.
Sure. My after it'll be brief. This is a terrific group. It's far more technical beyond my pay grade, but I'm fascinated listening to this. I'm in treatment number 4 out of 25, low dosage radiation. I go every morning, it's Sloan Kettering. And so the seeds have been implanted, so I'm dealing with stage 2 here. But the treatment is underway, takes about 20 minutes. I'm told in about 2 to 3 weeks I'm going to start to feel some fatigue, but right now I don't feel anything differently at this point. Mm-hmm. Maybe, you know, urinating a little more frequently, but otherwise I don't detect anything that's different in my body. Mm-hmm. But I'm told to expect some fatigue in a while here and get some more rest. But it's going well. Great people at Sloan. I give them very high marks. Have confidence in the whole team that's treating me. So that's my update. If anyone wants to know more about the procedure, I welcome people contacting me.
Okay, so just to let people know that Steve had 4+5. It was upgraded to 4+5 by Epstein, and he chose to have seeds and pelvic radiation. But I don't think you're doing hormone therapy. Is that right, Steve?
Yeah, because there was some conflicting, the cores of the biopsy were read by 3 different groups, Sloan, Yale, Johns Hopkins. 2 out of the 3 agreed with 3+4, and for that reason, we're not doing the hormone. Had it been the higher
right
score, I think I would have been in for a long treatment of hormone. So I'm trusting that 2 out of the 3 got it right. 3+4 and no hormone treatment is planned at this point.
And you didn't do any neoadjuvant. You didn't do any before you started the IMRT either, huh?
That's correct.
Yeah. Okay.
Just so everybody knows, a complicating factor with me is I have 2 hip resurfacing, so that there's metal in my body that does interfere with, and therefore I was not a candidate for the high dosage radiation, which apparently requires a lot more precision, and the metal would interfere with that. So I'm going with the more traditional approach, and I'm told it's not a problem, but I was not a candidate for the high dosage radiation. So.
Okay. All right, well, keep coming back to us, and do try and, I know you got a lot on your plate with work and the radiation, but try and get a 10-15 minute walk in every day, because you're going to find that the radiation could possibly catch up with you from a fatigue standpoint. So it's just a good idea to keep those bones moving.
Rick, thank you. Absolutely. Got it.
Okay.
And good luck to everybody on this call. Thanks again.
Pleasure. Larry Fish, you're up.
Okay. Can you hear me?
We can hear you.
All right. Well, just want to follow up. I saw my unnamed local oncologist who didn't want to, my PSA had gone up from 0.1 to 0.2 to 0.208. And I wanted to get some scans. He didn't really want to promote that. He said it's not going to make any difference. You don't really need any scans at this point. You don't really need anything else. We'll just keep going and see what happens. And then I got to see my consultant at Sloan, Dr. Karen Audio, who I really like and still like. And she helped promote and to get a bone scan and my doctor finally had agreed to a CAT scan, and everything was looking okay. I was discussing some things with her, just 2 points I wanted to make. I was talking to her first about Xtandi, maybe adding enzalutamide at this point. And rather than like the concept of throwing everything at the cancer concept, she was saying that she felt that at this point I should still hold off, that she felt that Xtandi usually has a certain range of effectiveness, 4 to 6 months or maybe longer for the other people, and that maybe I didn't want to use that up at this point until I was clearly castration resistant, that I hadn't reached that that point of being defined as castration resistant, because there hasn't been three consecutive rises yet. And that was one idea that I wanted to just throw out, was what people thought about that versus the idea of throwing everything at this as fast as possible.
Okay, so this is an old Talmudic debate in the prostate cancer world as to whether you go sequential or whether you go combination. Snuffy Myers for many years has been the archdeacon of combination treatments, triple blockade, you throw everything at it that you can. And I must say that, you know, back in the around 2008 to 2010, when I first started doing this work, and I didn't understand why you wouldn't do that. But what we have found, and what most of the doctors, not all, but most of the doctors in the centers of excellence prefer, is a sequential approach, exactly what Dr. Audio is recommending, and that you milk each drug for the very longest that you can get out of it. And the reason that I've heard explained for this from frequently over the years is that the quicker you expose the prostate cancer to more drugs, the more likely it is to change its form, to morph into a more untreatable type of the disease. And you hear a lot of these guys like Thibaut earlier on, who are struggling to find a drug that will control his disease, or Frank. And one of the reasons is because their disease has changed and it's become much more like a small cell or neuroendocrine prostate cancer. It may not actually be that, but it behaves like a small cell or neuroendocrine prostate cancer, because that's how it has responded to surviving in the face of so many drugs. So we often say, take these drugs sequentially. Giving enzalutamide too early may work, but it may also be a bad thing. Wait until you need it. Hopefully that answers your question. You were talking about, or we talked to you about possibly dropping the Casodex to see if that had a result. Have you discussed?
You know, I also mentioned that, and she said the same thing. She said, "Well, not yet. Let's wait another 3 months." I talked to her about whether I should have PSA tested monthly, and she said, "You know, at this point, that creates too much anxiety for people, usually, when you're waiting for your results. And at your point, you can wait another couple of months and see if you can get three consecutive raises. And then that would be the next step before Xtandi, before enzalutamide." There's another question. I heard a couple of times the talk about...
Hold on 1 second. I just want to check in with everybody and make sure that there are no questions. Nobody wants to talk to you about that, or... Anybody want to address that?
Yeah, I mean, this is Skip. I have a couple comments, because I'm on the Lupron and Casodex too. I get the shots monthly and take the Casodex pills daily. And my medical oncologist two of them have talked to me about switching from Casodex to Xtandi, thinking that, you know, basically describing the Xtandi as Casodex on steroids. A more powerful drug that may do a better job of doing what it's supposed to do. And I've resisted it, thinking if my PSA is under control with the Casodex, why go to the Xtandi? I agree with you, Rick. Why go to the Xtandi? Save that for a later time when you really might need it.
I mean, Skip, it's interesting, Skip, because you know, these guys, the guys who are the independents, like your guys and Peter Kafka's guys, and I have a lot of respect for, not for all of them, but I think that the guys down at prostate specialists, cancer specialists in Marina Del Rey are great, but they do like to throw the drugs earlier at the disease. That's their,
right.
That's what they do. And you
right.
have to be aware of it, you know.
Right.
I don't know that there's any proof that it works better, but that's their style.
Yeah, and, you know, there's more side effects associated with the Xtandi, and, you know, if you're achieving success with the Casodex, why should you step it up? There's also a huge economic difference, too, yeah, between the two drugs.
Absolutely.
Yeah, most insurance companies won't approve, you know, abiraterone or enzalutamide unless you are castrate resistant, where it's going up in the presence, like we talked about earlier. So that's the other thing, is economic. You know, they're not going to approve it. You're going to pay for it out of pocket.
Yeah, well, you know, seemingly, though, my medical oncologist must have a great relationship with Medicare, because somehow they got it approved after only a month on Casodex. So, but I've resisted making the switch because I've been successful on the Casodex.
Yeah, but one other comment is that this applies to anti-androgen therapies only. If you're talking about radium-223 or other therapies that are not specific for prostate cancer in the sense that they kill everything in their path, then it doesn't apply. You know, and radiation is another good example, and chemo for that matter. This conversation is really around anti-androgen therapy only.
Yeah.
Correct.
So,
I know that's correct.
Let's just quickly finish your other point. I want to touch base with Mike Tamales really quickly, because we're already at 7:05. Go ahead.
It's kind of quick. It's I know we've been talking about suggesting Crestor rather than Lipitor or other statins. I noticed that I just started taking Lipitor, the other statin,
right,
the generic, and I feel very tired from that. Is that the side effect that they're talking about, the drug interaction, which is the reason for switching to Crestor? I didn't really understand what were the interactions that led to the decision to switch
Crestor interacts with, somebody help me. I forgot this last time, then I researched it, and now I'm having a senior brain again. I can't blame it on ADT anymore. Jake, do you remember? What was the drug it was one of the prostate cancer drugs that the Crestor does not interact with, but the other ones do. Do you remember?
Len? No, I don't.
Len?
Yeah, I remember there was a conversation around that. It was more theoretical, though. I don't know.
I'll have to follow up with you offline, because it's just not coming to me right now. But I know that I emailed it to a couple of people, but I just don't have time to look for it right now. But the reason why Crestor recommended is because it doesn't interact with certain other prostate cancer drugs that are often given. Oh, and by the way, the other benefit of Crestor is, if you like grapefruit, you can have grapefruit with Crestor, but you can't with the Lipitor, with the simvastatin.
Right. I'm sure this will get clarified over the next few sessions.
Well, I'll make sure I look it up, and I'll tell you afterwards. Steve, I would love to talk about acupuncture, but we're not going to have time tonight, but hopefully in the next session.
I'm out of time also, so no problem. We'll do it another time.
Okay. Mike Tamales, you're last. I just want to see how you're doing with your new oncologist.
Well, I like him a lot. He spends a lot of time with me. I just got a quick question. I know you guys discussed this last week, but he put me on Xtandi, and I'm developing this peripheral neuropathy. And so he said stop taking Xtandi for a while and see what happens. And
we just lost Steve, because that was what he wanted to talk about, was the peripheral neuropathy and Xtandi.
Yeah.
And he's the man. Can we,
Rick?
Yes.
It's Richard Foody.
Yes, Richard Foody. How are you?
Good, thanks. How are you doing? So, I developed a peripheral neuropathy too with the Xtandi.
Okay.
And what's the question, or what's the, how can I help?
What did you do for it?
Well, I went to see a, what is this guy called? Like a nerve doctor.
A neurologist.
And, I'll look him up.
Neurologist,
okay. Yeah, so a neurologist, and they tested my, all of my nerves. They put electrodes in me and things like that. And, you know, that confirmed that I had a mild peripheral neuropathy. There really is not a lot that they can do. I mean, if you choose to stop taking the Xtandi, then you lose the benefit of the Xtandi. The doctor had said to me that since you know, it was just developing, one thing to do was to keep active, exercise. And the rationale for that is that you keep, by exercising, your blood is flowing and your body's working at, you know, closer to 100% than if you're just sedentary. And so if when you're sedentary, you know, it's, your body's not really flushing itself out and helping itself, whereas when you're exercising, the body's helping yourself and repairing itself. So, and he said that at some point, generally speaking, the neuropathy will, from his experience, you'll reach a level and it'll stop. So I developed it in my ankles, my calves, and it would alternate. It wasn't constant either. It wasn't every day's, and it, I could have it sometimes on both sides, sometimes just on one side, and it is very mild. Let's see what else can I say about it. It's
so let me come in here. It is a possible side effect, Mike. Believe me, I know it's really painful because I'm suffering with some mild neuropathy right now. I just actually, for me, I just popped a couple of ibuprofen before this call started, and it certainly eased it. You know, so you might try something as simple as that, provided you can take ibuprofen right now. I don't know, but it certainly eased my discomfort today because I'm having trouble walking. I've been having trouble walking. I get it on the soles of my feet, that my heels and my toes and my soles. Steve Bornstein wanted to talk about, he's on Xtandi, he's got some mild neuropathy, and he wanted to talk about acupuncture. Acupuncture is really a good alternative, and Richard Foody, I'm sure you can access acupuncture through Memorial Sloan Kettering.
Correct.
So you might want to talk to Dr. Radcliffe about giving you a referral so you can see if the acupuncture helps you at all next time it flares up, next time the neuropathy flares up.
You're at Memorial Sloan Kettering?
Say that again?
Is he at Memorial Sloan Kettering?
No. I'm saying you. I'm saying...
Oh, a referral for the acupuncture. Okay, got it.
Right. I'm saying that next time your neuropathy flares up, talk to Dana about maybe giving you a referral for some acupuncture, because you'll be able to get... I'm certain you'll be able to get acupuncture at the Integrative Center at Memorial Sloan Kettering.
Yes.
And it's a known treatment. Mike Tamales, you'll probably find that your insurance covers acupuncture for neuropathy.
I'm not sure.
Well, you can check with them, or you can ask. Yeah. You can ask your doctor's office, the new doctor Okazaki or whatever his name is, to check with them and see if it covers neuropathy, if it covers acupuncture. We'll come back to this because clearly it's an issue that affects a lot of guys. Neuropathy does affect a lot of guys. I want to hear what Steve has to say about it. And I'll ask him to, next time I see him on the call, I'll raise it with him. All right, guys, we've run over about 15 minutes. We're going to call it a day. Some of us are hoping to see the second half of the college game tonight. That's about it. There's been some interesting stuff on this call. Again, if you benefited from what you heard here, if we were saying good things, don't forget us in terms of Amazon Smile or a donation. We really appreciate that, and hopefully we can just keep bringing you the right sort of information that improves your treatment on a daily basis. Okay. I'll say good night to you all.
All right, thanks, everyone.
Thanks a lot.
Bye.
Thank you, Rick.
Good night, everybody.
Good night,
Rick.
Good night, guys.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.